Hello, I'm the Media Whiz, because one art form wasn't enough, and today we're going to be looking at 2006's Romeo and Juliet Sealed with a Kiss. Now, just like with the Shaggy Dog video, I was going to do this as a review, but after writing up the script and, you know, putting in jokes and stuff like that, I noticed that a bunch of other reviewers who've talked about this movie basically made a lot of the same points, so I figured, I'll just talk about the movie in a vlog instead. Here we go. The movie was directed by Phil Niblink, who is a Disney animator. He worked on Roger Rabbit. He worked on, this isn't a Disney movie, but he worked on An American Tale. He also directed that We're Back, a Dinosaur Story movie. Yeah, it's for anyone that was curious. But this movie was a huge passion project for him. This took 4.5 years to animate. And I gotta say, we'll touch on this a little bit later, but the animation in this was better than the last animated passion project I talked about, which was Sir Billy, which was terrible. So there's that. And yeah, Phil Niblink, he put his all into this. He wrote, produced, directed this, and he edited it, and he even does some voices in it. So he made this whole movie by himself. So that's a little impressive. I mean, especially compared to Sir Billy, which took about, I want to say around the same time. Like, the production started in 2008 and it finished in 2012. I don't know, maybe it's because it's a 2D animated movie compared to Sir Billy, where the CG animation is like, it makes like the early animations of Jimmy Neutron look good. But anyway, so let's talk about the story itself. So it's Romeo and Juliet with sea lions. Since it's a kids movie, they toned down a bunch of stuff, and we'll get into that as we go. So we have these two different groups of sea lions. We got the Montagues and the Capulets, and they're feuding with each other. The narrator even says at the beginning, no one knows how or why or when it started, but all you need to know is they hate each other. And there's this elephant seal called the Prince who rules over them, and at the beginning of the movie he shows up to establish a place called Shark Island where characters are banished to die. So there's that. So we meet Benvolio and Mercutio, and they're buddies with Romeo, and they go to tell him that, oh, we're going to go over to a Capulet party tonight, disguised. And when we see Romeo, and same goes for Juliet, they look younger than these characters. And it's like, why would you make your main leads look like they're kids? But like, they have adult voices, but they look like chibis. Like, they have big heads, smaller bodies, giant eyes. And it's like, it just feels like tonally different, because like they look so much different and so much younger than the other characters. But whatever. So now we jump into the first song of the movie, and it has an okay beat, but honestly, Romeo's singing voice, he sounds bored with his own song. And basically the song is talking about how he doesn't want to go to the party because he wants to find the right girl. But I find it funny because that's the whole reason they jump into this song, because it's like, I don't want to go to the party, I don't want to meet just any girl, I want to find the girl who's right for me. But then as soon as the song ends, the first thing he says is, let's party! Okay, the power of music, I guess. So they go to the party, and he's like, it's a Capulet party, they'll kill us! And then they roll around in the snow, and they look white, just like the Capulets, because the Montagues are like brown seals. Pretty sure that's not how snow works. It works like powdered sugar, I guess, in this cartoon world. So they're at the party. This is where Romeo and Juliet meet. Juliet is supposed to marry the prince, but obviously she falls for Romeo. But then the truth comes out when the prince sees that Romeo's trying to move it on his girl. And then the three of them, Romeo, Mercutio, and Benvolio, they jump off, land in the water, because the party was on like this like old ship, and they end up in the water, and their snow comes off, and it's revealed that they're Montagues. So then after that we get the famous balcony scene, but obviously like they rewrite some of the dialogue to make it like, oh, you know, like puns off of, you know, stuff like sea lions and stuff. Haha. Yeah. So they talk for a little bit, and you know, they confess their love for one another. My favorite thing though is they jump into a song sequence, and the first line is, I love you for who you are. Even though these characters met like an hour or so ago and all they did was slow dance together, but they looked into each other's eyes and they just love each other, I guess. And then as soon as the song is over, Romeo goes, Juliet, will you marry me? And then they do. They go to a character named Friar Lawrence, who's probably the best character in the movie. He has some of the funnier lines. Like when Romeo and Juliet show up to get married by him, they're in like in just constantly kissing, and then he's like, "You want to save that for after the wedding?" He gets some of the better lines in the movie, and he actually contributes a lot to the plot. So he marries them. These two go off to be together for a honeymoon in a ship that I remember Bob Show said in his video is supposed to be the Titanic. They reference Titanic. They do the thing from the James Cameron movie where, you know, Jack's holding up Rose and she's like, yeah, it's that's that whole thing. I'm like, huh, I guess it is the Titanic. Thank God there's no rapping shark in this movie or flamboyant gay cartoon wind-up toy fish rapping on about party time. So there's one part where Romeo trips underwater and I'm like, they somehow animated a character tripping underwater. Okay. And then all the undersea life don't take too kindly to a Montague and Capulet together. Why it impacts them, I don't know. Maybe they hate it just based on the fact that the sea lions hate it. There's a bit of a spat between the undersea life and our two lovers, but they get out of there, go to this waterfall area, and here is where we meet probably the most annoying character in the movie. Her name is Kissy the Kissing Fish. And, she's basically here to be the token kid character of the movie, and, yeah, she has, like, it's just cutesy little girl dialogue of just, like, you know, ooh, you guys are in love. It gets really, really annoying after a while. There's one part where she sings Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, and it comes right out of nowhere, and then she just kind of leaves after it, and I'm just like, the only thing that Kissy contributes in this whole sequence is she lets them know that the prince isn't going to take too kindly to them being together when Juliet was supposed to marry him. So Romeo goes to tell the prince about this, and just as it seems the prince is about ready to kill him, Mercutio comes and saves the day with his bad jokes, because that's the whole thing with Mercutio. He's supposed to be the one-liner zinger. Like, you can totally tell that they wrote him to be the funny character, and a lot of his zingers are just like, They're either written to be intentionally bad or they just are that bad. Because in this scene, Romeo and Mercutio are being chased by the prince up the perch that Juliet was on earlier in the movie during the balcony scene. And the prince presumably kills Mercutio, and as he's dying and falls off, he goes, "Romeo, tomorrow you will find me a grave seal." And it's like, his jokes are all like that in the whole film, and it's like, okay, great. So you think that Mercutio's dead at this point. Romeo and the prince fall off the perch. You think they're dead, but then, you know, oh, they're fine. And the prince banishes Romeo to Shark Island. And he just kind of sits on this rock formation as sharks circle around him. But the sharks do, like, make no effort to try and get him. Okay. Then the prince has a villain song, which is just kind of mediocre. It's not really that good. It's better than the first few songs, but it's funny because the song that follows has like a Poor Unfortunate Souls kind of vibe to it, and honestly, like, I think it would have worked better if that was the villain song, but even still, that was one of the better, that was probably the best song in the movie because it was Friar Lawrence's song, and it actually actually moves the plot forward. Basically in this song, the friar has a plan to set things right that it's a sleep potion that'll put Juliet to sleep, and, you know, everyone will think that she's dead. Benvolio goes off to tell Romeo about this because he thinks that she's really dead. Friar Lawrence tries to go after him, but then he ends up getting chased by a shark. And this results in kind of a rap number. At least the shark wasn't rapping. At least the shark didn't start with, "Yo, yo, yo, look at my teeth." Thank God that didn't happen. Oh, man. So, Benvolio goes to Romeo, tells him about this, and, Romeo goes back to see what's going on. And then we cut back to Friar Lawrence being chased by the shark, and then Kissy shows up and saves him, so I guess she did a thing. That part reminded me, oh my god, I remember when Nostalgia Kid reviewed this, but it reminds me of that one part in Shark Tale where all the shrimp show up and, like, attack the shark when he's stuck in the side of the ship. That's what that was like. I'm like, oh my god, this movie's reminding me of Shark Tale. Oh no. It has better animation than Shark Tale, though. Romeo gets there, sees that Juliet is dying. He kisses her. Then he gets a little bit of the potion, and then he falls dead. And the Montagues and Capulets, they all have a good cry, and then Friar Lawrence shows up and says, you know, why are you hating? You should be, you know, you should be loving each other and all that kind of stuff. So now the two groups are finally together. Romeo and Juliet wake up, and they can finally be together. And oh, it turns out Mercutio wasn't dead, which they established earlier. It was like after the scene where Lawrence and Juliet made the potion, there's a part where Mercutio shows up and he goes, "What a tangled web we weaved." So we already knew he wasn't dead. This reveal was not a reveal. Oh, and the prince finds an elephant seal female that he can hook up with. So everybody got somebody to love. Movie's over. In conclusion, this movie, it's bad, but it's got elements to it that I think actually kind of work. I mean, songs, mediocre, with one song probably being the best one, that being the potion-making song. Because the story itself is just kind of a really, really, really abridged version of the Romeo and Juliet story, with stuff that they obviously altered to make it like, oh, it's a family movie. But this is just like, okay, it's kind of paint by numbers. It's a little cliche in certain scenes. Characters aren't really all that fleshed out. I will say this, though. The best thing I can say about the movie, the positive that I can give, is that it's not horribly made. Like, the voice acting sounds decent. The animation is probably the best thing about it, even though there's parts where the animation, like, you can clearly tell, like, some scenes were animated better than others. But, yeah, this isn't, like, one of those... It's not like Aladdin and the Adventure of All Time, which looked like a CDI game. This actually does look, like, semi-decent. While it's far from one of the worst movies I've ever sat through, it's still just... yeah, didn't really care for it all that much. So, that's Romeo and Juliet sealed with a kiss. Tune in next time. I'm going to be doing another movie vlog. In this case, I'm going to be talking about Superhero Movie, which is another parody movie, except unlike some of the other ones I've talked about, like Disaster Movie, I actually kind of like this one. So see my video on that coming soon. So until then, I'm the Media Wiz, because one art form wasn't enough.